This material is made available to you by or on behalf of the University of Melbourne under Section 113P of the Copyright Act 1968. It may be subject to copyright. For more information, visit the University Copyright website.
Good afternoon. Sorry for the delay because this lecture theater was locked. Data converter. So we already started a data converter in the last lecture. You will be using a data converter, that is ADC. Then you are also using another data converter, DAC. So both you are using. So we deliberately chosen DSO. Why? Because the DSO is a complex system. Plus, you will be using both the data converters. Because that's because this is not just a project. Our aim is you will get exposure to as many blocks as possible in the system design. So that's the reason in the DSO, we have included ADC and DAC. Because ADC, you are converting your analog signal to digital in the DAC. Where DAC is used? Yeah, in the trigger. In the trigger, you are converting digital signal to analog signal. So then now we are going to study a bit more about data converters. So what is a data converter? It says from the definition, what is? From the definition itself, we can understand, even from the question, data converter. It is converting the data from one domain to another domain. So data converters bridge the digital analog divide by either converting from continuous time signal to a discrete signal or from a discrete signal, that is a digital signal, to a continuous time signal. Due to the limitations of conversion circuitry, inherent limitations are placed upon the analog bandwidth and accuracy of reproduction, means when you convert the signal. So why do we have to study the data converters? Firstly, we need data converters, so we have to study. Secondly, without studying, you won't understand what are the issues these data converters will make in your system. Then because the data converter, for example, ADC, will decide how you will be designing your filter. Because now you already designed the filter because we already told you the bandwidth, the requirement. But then if you, when you are using ADC, actually ADC sampling frequency will decide the cutoff frequency, maximum cutoff frequency of your low pass filter. We will come to that point. Then why do we need data converters? Some people might ask, why do you need data converters? Then you should be giving an answer, because data converters are required. For example, then you can say there are two types of data converters. One is ADC, another one is DAC. So why do you need ADC? We need ADC because in the front end, all the real world signals are analog. So you sense the analog signal, amplify, but in order to process, you need to convert into digital platform. Otherwise, you can't process, you can't store it, you can't store analog signal. So you need to conversion, you need that conversion. So that is the reason you need data converters. Then DAC, when you convert into digital, you need to convert into analog back again. And so that's the reason we need DAC. Then sampling theorem. So sampling theorem you might have studied in your previous subjects. So when you have analog input, then you got an anti-aliasing filter. So anti-aliasing filter is also called a low-pass filter. Then here is a sampling quantizer codifier. So these three together we form an ADC. In the ADC, you will find sampling part, quantizer, and codifier. And when it comes to DAC, in the DAC transcoder, then you got a sample and hold, then a reconstruction filter. Anyway, you don't have to study in detail. We will be studying ADC a bit more in depth, but we don't have to study DAC in depth, but we will be anyway studying DAC. Once you study ADC, pretty much all the characteristics are applicable, like some errors happening in the ADC, those are applicable in the DAC, but the other way around. Then, so why it is called anti-aliasing? So that's what we are going to look at today. And then a little bit about sampling, because sampling will create error in your signal. So that's what we are going to study. So sampling theorem. So if you like maths, you will like maybe transfer functions and a symbol transforms, a sampler transforms a continuous time signal into a sampled data equivalent. Ideally, a sampler yields sequence of delta functions whose amplitude equals the signal at the sampling time. So if you got a continuous signal, how to make it digital domain? So it is sampling. You use a clock and sample it here, sample it at time t here. So this is a clock frequency. Sample it here, sample it here. So then you are getting kind of, you are reproducing kind of analog signal. So that is the reason the clock frequency is very important. If you got a very high clock frequency, then you will get exact replica of your analog signal. That is the reason if you want to exactly replicate this analog signal, then what is the frequency of the clock? You need infinity. That is the reason higher the clock, better the resolution. Because here if you are using this clock, here you are sampling one point. But if there is a small variation here, you are losing it. Then you are sampling at this point and this will extrapolate like a straight line. So something here, there is a variation, it will not be captured. So that is the reason you need a very high frequency clock in the ADC if you want to accurately capture the characteristics of your analog signal. Then Nyquist rate. So Nyquist rate is the unaliased frequency achievable by a given sampling range such that under perfect conditions, the signal could be replicated exactly. So unaliased, we will be studying what is aliased and unaliased. But Nyquist frequency, so this is an equation you can understand. What is Nyquist frequency? That is equal to sample, how much frequency you are using for sampling divided by 2. Any frequency which is above the Nyquist frequency will be folded into the spectrum of interest and such said to be aliased. So that is the reason we use a higher frequency clock for ADC, and then that clock will decide what is the maximum cutoff frequency you can have it in your low pass filter. So then this aliasing, anti-aliasing we used, and then meantime, just hold on. What we will do is for Nyquist frequency is your sample frequency divided by 2. So your clock frequency is x, then x by 2, that is a Nyquist frequency. So the next slide will explain a bit more when you come. So this is example an ADC. So they already said the maximum sampling frequency 60 mega samples per second here. And then so mega samples per second, but this one also can use 20 mega samples per second to 60 mega samples per second. So that is a range. And then here when you see 60 mega samples per second, then what will be the Nyquist frequency? 30. Yeah, that's a simple, you know, 30. That is a, so then that is the maximum bandwidth you can have in your filter. Yeah, bit more we need to understand. Then only, you know, it will be clear. So what do you mean by aliasing? Because we already talking about what is aliasing, anti-aliasing filter. Low-pass filter is also called anti-aliasing filter. In order to find anti-aliasing, we should study what is aliasing. So effects of undersampling. So if you undersample it, possible to interpolate high-frequency components as low-frequency one. So then what will happen is, if your clock frequency is very small, then high frequency components will be folding back to the low frequency one. We will see that example. These errors are said to be caused by aliasing. Important to proceed analog to digital converter with a low pass filter to remove high frequencies. So that's the reason we need a low pass filter in front of ADC, known as anti-aliasing filter, because that is avoiding the aliasing. So now we are going to study aliasing. So this is your signal. So you got this signal that is coming through. Then what will happen is you are going to sample it. Your clock frequency is very, very small. So you will be sampling here, then you will be sampling here, you will be sampling here, because your clock frequency is very small. Then ADC will reproduce a signal. From here it will extrapolate like this, and then you use a DAC. Then you connect this to a DAC. Then DAC will reproduce maybe this signal, see? So that's a low frequency signal. And then this signal, actually it is not, it was not there in your case, but then it came up newly created because of the sampling error. And another example is this one. So you got this signal. So if you are using, you got a sinusoidal signal, and then if you are using same frequency as the clock frequency, so this one is 2, maybe 1 kilohertz. So that is your sinusoidal signal is 1 kilohertz. Maybe I should draw it. So what it says is, so you got one signal like this, and then this is a 1 kilohertz signal that is going to the ADC. And then here you got a clock that is also 1 kilohertz. So your clock is 1 kilohertz. Then what will happen is, it might sample this point, because your clock may be coming here, and then it is coming down, again it is coming here, it is coming down, it is coming here. So the leading edge, maybe it is sampling here, it is sampling here, it is sampling here. So you are getting a, then what will happen is, actually what you are getting here, the sampled data is some kind of a straight line. Or sometimes it can sample here, 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 or here, maybe here, here. Almost it is kind of a linear, that is not the case. So that is the reason you can't use same frequency. So these two frequencies should not match. So now, second case is, you are going to sample your sampling frequency here. What I will do is, so this is called undersampling. Now what I am going to do is, so this I put at FS, sampling frequency. Now I am going to put FS, which is equal to 2 kilohertz. So if I put 2 kilohertz, what will happen is, here you are getting, so still now our clock frequency is, see, here, now it is here, and then this is a period, time period T. Now you are going to have two signals within this period. Then again you are going to have two signals like this. Same amplitude. So this is 1 kilohertz. This is 2 kilohertz. So when you have 2 kilohertz, then what is happening is, you know, here you are getting at least 2 points. From here you are getting 2 points. From here you are getting 2 points. So when it is 2 kilohertz, you may get something like this. Because here you are capturing 2 points. So you kind of, you know, you get some kind of a replica. So that is a Nyquist rate. So that is a Nyquist frequency. So here you are using 2 kilohertz because your signal is 1 kilohertz, and then you are sampling 2 kilohertz, double than that one. So that is a minimum requirement. So that is called a Nyquist. So this is a Nyquist. See, the Nyquist rate is the bare minimum requirement. I will not take this as my requirement, because this is kind of, you know, barely reproducing. You are okay on the borderline. So in the real application, then you might ask, if you are making a very good system, like I would design maybe 4F, 4 times the sampling. So your signal is, that is okay. 4 times is, you know, you are kind of fine. But then this will work. So this is a limit. This is a borderline, means this is a maybe maximum range you can sample. This is a, you should have at least twice. If your signal frequency is 1 kilohertz, then you should have at least your sampling frequency 2 kilohertz, double. So that is a bare minimum requirement. That is called Nyquist. So if you reduce it, then here, now what I am going to do is, this is 1 kilohertz, this is 2 kilohertz. Now I am going to sample with FS less than 1 kilohertz. Then what will happen? If I am sampling this signal, now I am going to sample, see, so this I am going to sample with a very, because like this, a big clock. Then what will happen is, I may sample here, maybe I will sample here, then I am getting an error. So then what will become is, I may get a replica of a low frequency signal. Actually that is not there, you are getting a low frequency signal. So that is called aliasing. And then this low frequency signal, because there's a sampling error. So that is called aliasing. So aliasing you should be avoiding. So that's what this figure shows. So that's what you are doing with your low pass filter. So here it is sampled at the same frequency. Your signal is 1 kilohertz. You are sampling your ADC with 1 kilohertz clock. Then you are getting a straight line. If you are sampling at twice the frequency of your signal, means you got a 1 kilohertz signal and ADC got 2 kilohertz. So that is the Nyquist. You are kind of, you know, getting that waveform. At least you are capturing the frequency, not the correct shape of the envelope. But if you reduce it 4F by 3, then what will happen is, you might be getting a low frequency one. You will be reconstructing. See, that's the reason I told you this one. So if you are clock frequency is smaller than the signal frequency, then you will be getting a low frequency signal. See, you might think that this is a signal you will be getting, but actually this is not the signal. So that is called aliasing. See, possible to interpolate high frequency components as low frequency one. So that's what it happened. So this may be 1 kilohertz, but then what you reproduced is maybe 50 hertz. Then you will think that, oh, that signal is 50 hertz. And these errors are said to be caused by aliasing. So this effect is called aliasing. So that is the reason we need anti-aliasing filter. So how it is going to help it? So we should do some example, then it will make it clear, is clear. So aliasing, so I have got this good example. Assume FS, so that is your sampling frequency. Sampling frequency is the clock frequency of your ADC. The sampling frequency is, here I have taken 100 hertz, so that is the clock. That the input signal contains the following frequencies. So your input signal may contain following frequencies. So your input signal got 25 hertz, 70 hertz, 160 hertz, and 510 hertz. So these are the four frequencies your input signal got it. These frequencies are shown in the following figure. So when I take magnitude versus frequency, I'm going to take your input signal. I'm going to take a Fourier transform of your input signal. So when I take Fourier transform of your input signal, I find out, I have got 25 hertz. See, I have got 70 hertz. I have got 160 hertz. Then I have got 510 hertz. And then when you have 100 hertz, that is your clock frequency, then your Nyquist frequency, which is half, half. So that is the reason here, FS by 2, see, sampling frequency divided by 2, 50. So 50 hertz is your Nyquist frequency. Then, but you are getting 70 hertz, that is much above the Nyquist frequency. You got 70, 160, see, and then 510. And then this is a magnitude, then our interest is only 25 hertz. So we want only this 25 hertz signal, but then you don't have an anti-aliasing filter. So then, so this is a scenario. Maybe I should draw it and then we will discuss. Then it will make sense. So you got an ADC and then clock frequency is FS. That is the clock frequency is 100 hertz. Then some input is coming, you want to convert into digital. But then your frequency of interest, because you are looking for some frequency, so that is equal to 25 hertz. So that is the frequency of interest. But then in your signal, so this is the input signal. So in your signal, what is happening is, maybe this is your input signal. But in your signal, when you take FFT, you got 25, then you got 70 hertz, then you got 160 hertz, then you got 510 hertz. But when you take FFT, you got all these things, but then our interest is in 25 hertz. Like, you got a signal, when you take FFT, maybe that frequencies are coupling from somewhere or which is in the signal itself. Or you are making a DSO, you want to only analyze up to 25 hertz. But in your signal, you got high frequency components. Then you are going to connect this directly to the ADC. But then our interest is only 25 hertz. Then what will happen? So when you connect this to the ADC, and then ADC got 100 hertz clock. When you have 100 hertz, so here Nyquist frequency equal to N Nyquist equal to FS by 2, that is equal to 50 hertz. Then that's what we are going to discuss. So now you will see what will happen. The frequencies below Nyquist are sampled correctly. Why? Because, so what it means is, why frequencies below Nyquist is sampled correctly? Because you got 25 hertz, and then, so 25 hertz, so 20, this is a 25, maybe your signal frequency is, when you take FFT, you will be getting maybe sinusoidal like this. So this is 25. Your sampling is 100. So then each period, you are getting 4 clock. You know what I meant? So then, so 25 is good. Then what will happen is, we are coming to 50. So when you come to 50, what will happen? So this is 50 hertz. Then 50 hertz, how many clocks are there? Yeah, 50 hertz, what will happen is, you are getting only 1 clock. So that is the reason up to 50 hertz, after this you will get error. Up to 50 hertz you are fine. So up to Nyquist frequency 50 hertz, you get, you know, correct sampling. But when your clock frequency is less than the signal frequency, then you will get aliases. Aliases means, for example, F1, that is our frequency, 25 hertz, appears at the correct frequency. So 25 will come here, but F2, 70 hertz. So 70 hertz is above the Nyquist frequency. And then what will happen is this 70 hertz will be sampled wrongly. So when 70 hertz is your frequency component, then your clock is 100 hertz. So what will happen? Then you are not going to get all the points. Then the 70 hertz will appear as 30 hertz because of the wrong sampling. Means what is happening is, I will draw it. So you got a 70 hertz. So here you are getting a 70 hertz. Then your clock is 100 hertz. So I'm going to draw a clock is 100 hertz means it's not much. So then my question is, this is 70 hertz. So from here to here is 70 hertz. So 100 hertz means, then maybe your clock is a little bit smaller than this one. So 100 hertz means, so your clock is starting from here, and then it might come down here, because this is a point, but then from here you are getting another signal. You know what I meant? But then you can see that here you are not getting the sampling correctly, because it is 70 hertz, it's above the Nyquist, so that you don't get enough sampling points. So then we can see your sampling frequency is 100, so then we can use, like, we can find out, because 70 is closer to 100, so 100 minus 70, which is equal to 30. So then you will find a 30 hertz signal, and then 30 hertz signal will appear here. Means after ADC, you connect to a DAC maybe, that's another way of checking. You connect to a DAC and then see what you are getting. Then you will be seeing a 25 hertz signal. Then you also will see a 30 hertz signal, but that was not there in your input, because that came because of your undersampling of 70 hertz by your clock. Then 160, so 160, that is near to the 200. So that is the reason we can find out 2 into 100. 100 is the sampling frequency minus 160. 40 hertz, so you are getting a 40 hertz signal again. From where it is coming? Again due to the undersampling. See, like this. So you are getting a signal, but then because your clock frequency is getting smaller, so you are getting kind of, you know, low frequency ones. So that's what here happening. And then you got another one at 510. So 510, what will happen is, again, 5 times 100 minus 510. So that is equal to 10 hertz. See, you are getting a 10 hertz signal here. So then, though your interest is 25 hertz, but then you are getting a 10 hertz signal, you are getting a 30 hertz signal, then you are getting a 40 hertz signal, and then all these high frequencies are folding back to the low frequency side. So that is called, that's the reason we call it as aliasing. So we need to avoid this aliasing. So that's the reason we need anti-aliasing filter. So how can we get rid of this one? So that's when then we will come back to the anti-aliasing filter. So that's the reason low-pass filter is called anti-aliasing filter. So then how to avoid this issue? Because you might think that your ADC, so it is pretty much easy to think in here. What you will think is your frequency of interest is 25 hertz. Okay, then you are using 100 hertz clock. But then it is logically, you might think that, oh, there is a signal at 160, why we should bother? Because anyway, that is higher than your signal sampling frequency. You know what I meant? You got another frequency component, 500 hertz. That is 5 times more than the sampling frequency. So you might think that, okay, those guys anyway are not going to be affected. But those guys are going to create problems. How it is going to create problem? That will be undersampled. And undersampled means this is 500 hertz, and then you are sampling with much lower clock. And then so that's the reason this is 500 hertz means this signal component means 500 means it is very small, like compact. Then you are sampling with a big clock. So that's the reason. So when you have 500 hertz, what is happening? So 500 hertz, So maybe I'll make this 500 hertz. See, so this is your 500 hertz clock. Sorry, 500 hertz signal, 500, so 5 ton. So 5 ton hertz signal is, this is a 5 ton. But then you are going to sample with 100 hertz. So then 100 hertz is, so what is the, so this is a period, this is a 5 ton hertz. So 100 hertz where it will be. So your clock will go come up here, where it will end. Yeah, yeah, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Something like this. So then what will happen is, this will sample here. Another sampling will happen maybe after so much time, the next leading edge comes. So that's the reason when you interpolate, you are getting a signal that is equivalent of 10 hertz. So that's how we are getting a 10 hertz signal. But then in order to avoid those situations, how can you avoid? Because if you don't want these signals coming into your, because these are the errors, it is not there actually in the signal. You are getting some signal, you are recovering some signal in the after the ADC, which actually not exist in the input signal. You know what I meant? Those frequencies are not there. And then how to avoid those one? You can avoid those one if you can take off these high frequencies. So that's what the filter is doing. So that's what your low pass filter is doing. So that's the reason you need a low pass filter before the ADC to make sure that you don't have any aliasing. You know what I meant? So then you are not getting any low frequency signal created out of error and folding into the region of interest. So then this will make sure. See, this is a very good diagram I got from a textbook. Actually, this is very good, easy to understand. So then this is your pass band for your low pass filter. Then this is your transition band. This is your stop band. Then we are going to draw the frequency of interest. Then ideally, so when you check it, this is your frequency of interest. Then the middle should be Nyquist. And then Fs minus Fb, that is your stop band. So why? Because, so if your Fb, so put Fb equal to 20 megahertz, because that is our interest. Say 20, Fb equal to 20 megahertz. So maybe you can work with me. So Fb equal to 20 megahertz. And then we are using a clock, maybe 60. I'm going to use a 60 megahertz clock. You might not be using 60, you might be using 40, but here I'm going to take 60. So I have got 40 megahertz, and then my clock is 60 megahertz. And then what is FS2 by 2? That is equal to 30 megahertz. Then what is the stop band? Where the stop band should start? So that is the Fs minus Fb. So your 60 minus 20, so that is how much? 40. So beyond 40, we don't want anything. Because if something is there, what will happen is this will be folding back to this region. So maybe I think next one, yeah, before going to next one, I think this is a best way to discuss. So I'm going to draw it. Maybe then it will be more clear. So this is your frequency of interest. Or other way we can say, two ways we can think. Either you can talk in terms of sampling clock, or you can talk in terms of frequency of interest. So FB, so that is your frequency of interest. I'm going to say that is my 20 megahertz is my frequency of interest. So when I have 20 megahertz as the frequency of interest, then I also got to hear, so this is my frequency of interest, 20 megahertz. So my input signal, is something like this. So that is the input signal. So I made some kind of, you know, triangular, so that when I take FFT, then I will be getting a 20 megahertz. Then I am getting a 40 megahertz. Then I am getting a 60 megahertz. Then I am getting 80 megahertz, I am getting 100 megahertz. So these are the signals I am seeing, see, I got a 20 megahertz, then I am getting a 40, then I am getting 60, I am getting 80, and then I am getting 100. But my input signal got these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 components. So this is a 20, and then this is a 40, and then I got a 60, 80, and 100. So this is 100, this is 80, this is a 60. But our frequency of interest is this one. So that is our FB. So our interest is this one. Then I am going to, use a ADC. So when I am going to use a ADC, actually I need only this signal because that is my frequency of interest. I don't need these signals. Then I know that when I have 20 megahertz signal, what is the minimum frequency I need? Minimum clock frequency? 40. So when I take 40 megahertz, then I think I get a very good sampling. So I'm going to take maybe 40 megahertz. Maybe that is good because 40 is good. So 40 megahertz if I take, then so my FS, that is going to be 40 megahertz. So if I do 40 megahertz, I'm pretty sure my 20 megahertz is kind of barely reproduced. That is kind of a borderline. You don't get the exact shape, but you will get that frequency. Frequency will be reproduced. So that is a minimum frequency, 40 megahertz. Then I am going to take 60 megahertz as my sampling. Because 60 is how much time? 3 times than your frequency of interest. So that you are going to get, you know, much better signal. So if I take FS equal to 60 megahertz, so then this is the FS. So my sampling frequency, FS also is 60 megahertz. So when you have 60 megahertz, you are getting 80 megahertz signal is there in your input. 100 megahertz is there. All are going to, you are going to connect to the ADC. And then your ADC got 60 megahertz clock or 60 mega samples per second. So that's what is happening. But then when you have 60, what is your Nyquist? So FS by 2, which is equal to 30 megahertz. So up to here, what will happen? Your sampling is good. So then when you see ADC output, up to FS by 2, everything is good. But when it is 40 megahertz, then what will happen is you got 60 megahertz clock. Then what will happen? Okay, 60 megahertz, you are sampling with 60 megahertz. What will happen? Yeah, you are getting kind of a straight line. Then you are sampling 80 megahertz signal with 60 megahertz. You will get low frequency. Your 100, maybe you should put one more, 120, maybe 100. So 100, what will happen? Again, you are getting the low frequencies. Then you can minus it. So your 100 megahertz, your sampling frequency is 60. And then when you have 60, then where will appear the aliasing for the 40 megahertz? So I'll divide it. So up to here, everything is fine. So up to here, everything is fine. But then here, all these things will happen is when it is aliasing, it will be coming to this side, folding back. You are getting these signals will be coming to this side after sampling. Here you will be getting all the effect. But then if you want to get rid of this effect, what will happen is you want to make sure that all these high frequencies are suppressed before going to ADC. You know what I meant? So that is the reason you are putting a low pass filter. Whenever you got ADC, then you will be having a low pass filter. That is called anti-aliasing, because anti-aliasing. So anti-aliasing means you are preventing the aliasing by removing all the high frequencies. So that after your ADC, you are getting only this 20 megahertz. Otherwise, you will have maybe 10 megahertz and so on, low frequencies. Now my question is, when this is FS by 2, then FS minus FB. So what is how much is that one? FS equal to, what is FS? 60 minus FB equal to 20, so which is equal to 40. So after 40, because up to 40, it is okay. But after 40, what will happen is all the things will be folding back to your frequency of interest. Fs minus Fb, so that is a, we have to stop it. So Fs minus Fb is your Fs equal to 60 megahertz, that is a clock frequency, and then your frequency of interest is equal to 20 megahertz. So 60 minus 20, that is equal to 40. So from 40, you need to suppress it. See, all these, you know, you should be stopping. So from here, you need to stop. But then, why? So my question is, when you have 40 megahertz, so then here I'm, you know, then you will understand. So this is the 40 megahertz. So you got 40 megahertz. Then you are, so from here, it is starting, and then the signal is increasing, and then it is coming here, see. So this is 40 megahertz. Then I'm going to clock. So my clock is how much? So 60 megahertz. So when 60 is coming, this is 40. Then what will happen? How many clocks? So 40 megahertz or 60 megahertz, which one is big? Yeah, yeah. So 60, then what happens is here you are getting a leading edge, and then it might, you know, come here. It will come here, and then again it will increase before this one. Because you are getting a some 1 point something clock like this. Then what will happen is, then what will happen? So you will be getting, so here then, you are getting 40, you are sampling twice. You know what I meant? And then when you are 40, at least you are getting 2 sampling points. In that case, you are getting some frequency. That frequency is going to appear where? Will it come here or will it come where it will come? It will come before 20 megahertz or it will come after 20 megahertz? I'll give you 1 minute. It's a simple question. Okay, maybe if you got confusion, seems you got a bit confusion. So hang on with this one. We will answer this second. First, maybe please answer this one. So you got your signal. This is your another frequency of interest. So that is a 60, sorry, this is a, yeah, I think 40 megahertz is good. Sorry, this is the first one. 40 is good. Because if I say the first one, then you know it's easy. I'm giving you the clue. So if you want to find out, why don't you apply this mathematical rule? So you got a 60, and then your input is 40. You are using a clock of 60. Then how will I find out where it is falling? It's very easy. So your 60 is the sample frequency. So if you check my previous slide, see here what I did is, how will I find out? I got 70, I got 160, I got 510. So these are the frequencies. And then how will I find out aliasing? FA, I can find out where it is falling, which is the closest integer multiple of FS. That is FS minus F. So means when you have 70 hertz, so that is your one frequency, higher frequency in your input signal, and then that is a 70. Then FS, so what is the FS? FS equal to sampling frequency. So 100 minus 70, that is equal to 30. So that will appear in the 30. When it is come to 160, so 160 means then it is closer to the 200. So that is the reason we will be taking 100, that is the sampling frequency, minus 160, and then 160 is near to the 200. So that is the reason here we'll multiply, integer multiple is 2. 2 into 200 minus 160, so that your aliasing will be at 40 hertz. Then when it is come to 5 ton, so 5 ton means it is closer to 500. So that's the reason here it will take again FS, that is equal to 100 into 5 times minus 5 ton. So that is equal to 10 hertz. See, you can minus it. So easily we can find out where it is falling. Now you know where it is falling. See, so you lost the opportunity for a coffee. But the other two coffee guys, you know, I will be emailing you. Okay, soon you will get an invitation. So then where it will be falling? This error, so this one, where it will be falling? 20. Yeah, so then what will happen is this 40 megahertz one, it will be falling, that 40 will be falling in the 20, exact at the 20. You know what I meant? So then this one is falling here due to the error. So the error or alias. How about 60? How about 60 megahertz, where it will be falling? 80. So I do agree, 60. So 60 is where will happen? 60. 60 will come here. So these are the high frequencies. And then, so what I'll do is 50. Maybe I'll take another one. So we got another component here, maybe 50. 50 megahertz. So we got 50. How about 50? Where 50 will fall? Sorry? 10. See? So your 50 is coming. 50 is coming here as a 10 mega, 10. Then, how about, suppose we got another one, 30 megahertz also is there. So we got 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 80, 100. So these are very high, we don't have to worry because it's beyond the sampling frequency. And then, so 60 will be folding back to the zero, and then 40 will be falling to exact your frequency of interest. And then 50 will appear as 10 megahertz. That is, you know, within your frequency of, you know, within your frequency of interest. Now you got another one that is 30 here. Where 30 will come? Yeah, so 30. See, so will you bother this one? Are you concerned about this one? No. Why? Because your frequency of interest is 20. So when you are designing a low pass filter, where will you put the cutoff? Do you want to cut off from FS or you want to cut off from somewhere here? So where will you put in your exact cutoff frequency? Because the designing a low pass filter is very difficult. In this scenario, you encountered this issue. In your ADC, you found 10 megahertz, you found 20 megahertz, you found 30 megahertz, then you got already a 30 megahertz here. So these are the aliasing. So I'll be putting aliasing. See, aliasing, aliasing. So you got these things because of the aliasing. And then the 30 will come to here, 30. Then 40 will come exactly in your range. And then, so whatever the range coming here, that will appear here. Then, my question is, which frequency is the, which higher frequency? So if you are encountering this issue, what is the high frequency you will be stopping? So you don't need to, how much? So if you, because 30 anyway not creating an issue, because you see 20. Okay, so maybe I will explain like this. So then we found out, so you forget about everything. So we got, this is a, so you got an input signal. In the input signal you got, when you take FFT, you found out 20 megahertz, 30 megahertz, 40 megahertz. So I'm going to explain again, and then it will make sense. See, 20 megahertz, 30 megahertz, 40 megahertz, 50 megahertz, 60, 80, and 100. So anyway, these are very high. So these are the frequency components when you take FFT of your input signal. So these frequency components means these are the sinusoidal signals. And then when the FFT, we can represent this as an amplitude. And then these are the frequency. Then we will be getting something like this. Then our frequency of interest is only 20 megahertz. Okay. Then if you put this signal directly to the ADC, in the ADC output, ADC clock is 60 megahertz. So when you sample with the 60 megahertz, what will happen is all these 40, 50, 60, after Nyquist.